tri matiće.
Dobar dan i dobrodošli na današnji seminar koji nam je pred kolegica Sara Ivušić pod ovim naslovom. Seminar će biti na engleskom. Kolegica to zamolila da bude tako, jer ovdje nas pravi međunarodnu suradnju. Jednostavno tako je to lakše provoditi. Znači, u tom smislu ćemo malo odstupiti od standarda da bude na hrvatskom, nego da bude na engleskom. Pa evo, probajte nam sad po nekih 20-25 minuta. Izvolite.
Dakle, dobar dan, hvala vam svima što ste došli. Nastavit ću dalje na listu. So, the topic of my talk is the sensitivity of precipitation to the size of domain, domain position, and also the domain geometry. I will present you the spectral magic technique that eliminates the detrimental effect that domain configuration can have on precipitation. So these are the references that I have used for this talk. The first three are sensitivity studies. In the fourth one, the spectral magic technique is first time presented. And in the last one, the spectral magic technique is first time used on regional climate models. So global circulation models successfully reproduce large-scale features such as global synoptic circulation. And if we want to simulate, for example, precipitation, we need to have a well-represented small-scale processes and local orography. And we know that this is not possible with coarse resolution GCMs or global circulation models because also, it is computationally too expensive to run them at resolutions that are finer than 100 kilometers. And to represent well the regional scale features, we nest regional models into GCMs. There are all sorts of nesting methods. The most commonly used one is the one-way nesting. And if we speak in context of climate simulations, when we nest regional climate models into GCMs, that is called dynamical downscaling. As I have said already, the one-way nesting is the most commonly used method for the nesting. And we take global synoptic circulation, which is provided from the GCMs, and we impose that circulation through lateral boundaries and also in initial conditions. And since it's the one-way nesting, there is no feedback from the local to the global dynamics. So the forcing at lateral boundaries is first of all an ill-posed problem for the partial differential equations of the nesting model. And why? It's because we take the coarse atmospheric fields from GCMs and we interpolate them on the higher resolution grid of the nested model. And there lies a problem because this is not an exact solution of the model equations. So that could possibly lead to RNAs data propagating into the nested model. So these incompatibilities between the model solution and boundary conditions create an interaction between the model dynamics and the lateral boundaries, and in this way that affects the solution throughout the whole domain. And it has already been proved that nest models have produced large-scale features that are significantly different from those of the GCMs. So to eliminate this detrimental effect, the Davis approach has been introduced. So to ensure better consistency between model solution and boundary conditions, we use Davis approach. So some sort of a sponge zone or a buffer zone. So we are not imposing the lateral boundary conditions only at the boundaries, but over this zone that usually takes several grid points of this nested domain. And if we look at the basic nested model forecast equation, which is local change of a single forecast variable or a vector of forecast variables is equal to local influences that are tending to change this forecast variable. In the nested model, we can decompose these forecast variables to QO, or that represents all scales that are resolved by after model, and QI, that is all other smaller scales that are resolved only by the nested or inner model, that's why I. So, if we take this into account and place it in this equation, we get this, where we have the LQO from the outer model forecast, which is placed within the inner model domain, and also at the lateral boundary, we have that Q is equal to QO and QI, the local influences, the scales that are resolved only by the inner model are zero. So what does the Davis approach mean? It means that we include some sort of a nudging term on that sponge zone, and this is it. So we get this equation. The k term is a nudging coefficient. So it decreases as we go further into the domain of our inner model. And what does it do? So if our QI is greater than QO, the nudging term will cause a decrease in QI. In this way, and the other way around. So in this way, we damp the small scales discrepancies that accumulate, that are accumulated in the vicinity of the boundary. What happens with the large scales that they reflect from this boundary, and again they interfere within the domain. So in this approach, the larger scales are not treated correctly, and we get some sort of errors in the synoptic circulation, which translate to errors in all other variables, and especially in precipitation, which is extremely sensitive to dynamics. So the spectral nudging technique was introduced by Wozner et al. To eliminate this effect. We force large scales of the global model over the entire domain, so not just at the sponge zone or at the lateral boundary, but over the whole domain. And the small scales features are left for the regional climate model to develop. And what we do, we can do a Fourier expansion of the forecast variable in a grid point. So, as you can see here, we have Fourier coefficients and Km and Kn, which are components of wave vector. And they depend on the wave numbers m and n, and also on the domain size in x and y directions. So, in spectral nudging technique, the Davis nudging is kept, and we add additional steering, so which selectively chooses the scales we want to impose on the, on our regional model with this nudging coefficient that is similar to the Davis, but remember, we are nudging over the whole domain, and also we select the scales. So this nudging coefficient varies with wave numbers and also with height. So it is larger for long waves and small for shorter waves, shorter scales. So and. It is zero in the boundary layer, as we want to keep the regional model to develop the small scales, and it is increasing linearly and it becomes constant in the upper troposphere. So now I'm going to show you two sensitivity studies. First one is done by Colin et al. It's sensitivity of heavy precipitation to the size of the domain and the use of spectral nudging technique. They wanted to answer these two questions. So does the spectrometric technique deteriorate the modeling of heavy precipitation events? And which size of domain is preferable to use? Smaller or larger? So first of all, I'm showing you the models and the method. In this study, they used the Big Brother run, which is a type of a perfect model framework. In this framework, the nested model is driven by the same model, but on a larger scale and at the same high spatial resolution. What we want to get is a perfect reference here. So we want to be able to compare our nested model with our GCM, which is practically the same model but on global scale. So the Big Brother in this case is Arpège climate run on 50 kilometer resolution over 23 years. It's indicated as ARC50, and the reference it is used as a reference, as I already said, against the RCM simulations, and also it provides the lateral boundaries for the RCM, but the smaller scales are filtered, so to the resolution, so that the tower lateral boundaries are of resolution of 300 kilometers, and our RCM here is other than climate, also run on the 50 kilometer resolution, as they share the same computer code. They can be run with the same physical parameterizations and same dynamical scheme. So we have three experiments here. The first one is run over this smaller domain, which is also our domain of interest, as all the experiments share this part of the domain. So I will show you results only this part. Also, two other experiments are EU50 and EU50, which is run, they are run on this bigger domain, which is two times this smaller, and they have this one is not spectral enhanced and this one is, and they all have the Davis nudging applied. So as for the spectral nudging setup, the nudging coefficient that I meant is zero from surface to 880 hectopascals, and it's linearly increasing and to become constant above 750 hectopascals. The spectral nudging is not applied for scales that are smaller than 300 kilometers, and it's applied for scales that are larger than 400, and in between there is a linear transition. Also, the spectral nudging variables, I mean the variables that are spectrally nudged, are wind vorticity and divergence, temperature, surface pressure, and specific humidity. So now on to the results. I'm showing you here the bias of seasonal mean precipitation. This is the smallest domain, and these two are larger, and this one is spectrally nudged for winter and summer. We can see here that on our smallest domain, there is a significant dry bias on the western border that is weaker in summer. This is due to that boundary effect that I explained in the introduction. And why it is weaker in summer and stronger in winter is because of the westerly flow, which is stronger in winter. And if we look generally, all these kind of experiments are showing similar behavior, but if you look closely, you can see that the nudge version shows the smallest bias. So now onto the extreme precipitation. Here we have differences in daily precipitations 99.9.5. The results here are shown for ARC50 also, and for the difference, these are the differences. This is for the large domain with spectral nudging, and for the small domain. Also, we are not looking here at winter or summer, but we extend the seasons. So we have winter and spring, which is called the advective season, and we have summer and autumn as convective seasons. So if we look at, again, the smallest domain, we again see that intense precipitation is highly underestimated on the western borders of the domain. For the larger domain, we can see overestimations in western France and quite an underestimation on the northeastern boundary. Also, again, the spectral Nash version shows smallest biases.
Sorry. So those are all comparisons among different model versions. Here is no data.
No data. This is perfect model approach.
Yes, model. Yes. Small. Okay.
So the all errors that are shown are probably due to the nesting technique. So there is no dependency on the physics because it's the same in our global and our regional model. And now we go on to the quantile diagrams. You can see here that all the simulations stay fairly close to the GCM ARC 50, but except for Corsica and Sardinia. I don't know if you can see, but all simulations underestimate extremes more in convective season here than in advective. I forgot to explain that the quantile plots are made by. So we take daily precipitation from every grid point inside these boxes, and we sort them, and then we produce the spectra. So this is the large domain that is called MEDIT, and these are the smaller ones that I'm showing here now. So if you look at the results for the large box MEDIT, we can see that again our notched version is, I'm not sure if you can see, but the largest discrepancies come from the largest domain without spectral nudging, and the smallest domain is in between, and the spectrally nudged version shows the best results. And why are the results for Corsica and Sardinia so bad, let's say? It's because of the representation of complex orography in alanine and arpeggio climate, and also in land sea mask, which differ between those two models. Now on to the second study. This is done by Miguel Mancho. It's a spectral nudging to eliminate the effects of domain position and geometry in RCM simulations. So we are no longer in the Big Brother experiment. Here we have reanalysis. The N-step analysis, which provides initial and boundary conditions for our RCM. The RCM is RAMS version 4.3, run on the resolution 50 kilometers. The integration time is only for June 2000, because in that month there are large precipitation amounts over the Great Plains. You can see here the domain of our control experiment. Again, we have the daily nudging over 50 points thick sponge zone. And what are the experiments? So we have this control experiment, and then four experiments with the grid displacement, where the center of the grid is moved to the west, east, north, and south. Also, we have rotation. So this long axis is rotated this way. And we have changed the geometry, where we use a square domain. And all the physics and model is exactly the same. For all experiments, only the domain changes. And also, the same experiments have been done with spectral nudging, so which is applied only for wavelengths higher than 2,500 kilometers. The spectral nudge variables are wind, equivalent potential temperature, and perturbation eigenfunction. and moisture is not quenched. So you can see here the results for total precipitation without spectral imaging. So here we have the observations. This is control run. This is run where the domain was displaced north, south, west, east, and this is the rotated grid. This is the square grid. We have to keep in mind that all these grids cover the same area, but they are shown in latitude longitude for the projections. That is why they look a bit differently. Okay, so we can see here the results vary largely. So what we can see that the rotated experiment shows the best pattern, and but the amounts are largely underestimated. If we look closely, none of these show the pattern that we see in observations, because a lot of them show pattern that is more extending from west to east in the central domain, and some of them even shift this bed of precipitation to the south. So we can see here that displacing the grid leads to results that vary largely, also in, not just in amounts but in patterns. And why is this so? It's again because of that boundary conditions. Again, we have in this area we have some precipitation that is strongly correlated with the strength of the southerly low level jet, and there comes interaction again with the model solution with the boundaries, so and also the domain geometry. So we have bias patterns in circulation that again these biases not only affect the synoptic circulations but again precipitation. And if we apply spectral imaging, we can see different results, as there are no more variations when we displace the grid or change the the geometry. We can say that precipitation totals are reduced, but this can now be attributed to the physical parameterizations, no longer to the lateral boundary conditions, and most importantly, the small scales are free to develop. So, to conclude, I have showed you that interaction of the flow and lateral boundaries leads to small scale errors that can grow, and after that they can distort large scales. If we use the Davis approach to eliminate this, well, we will damp the small scales, but we are unable to stop the large scales from interfering all over the domain. And errors that we get in our synoptic circulations from this translates to errors in all variables, especially on precipitation. So if we apply spectral imaging technique that forces large scales onto the whole domain and leaves the smaller scales to be developed by a regional model, we will reduce mean biases without deteriorating the simulation of extreme precipitation that is shown in the first study. And in the second study, if we want to use a large domain, the spectral imaging is necessary to apply, because it eliminates influence on boundaries on large scales, and our results no longer depend on our domain configuration. So that's it.
Thank you, Sarah. What is the typical frequency of updating inner domain by, let's say, big brother domain line?
Yeah, I haven't put that. 6 hours. Six hours. Yes.
Please go ahead. Questions, comments? Okay, another comment. On another work of Martina Tuller, she has a couple of papers on a similar subject, but using LLM for operational weather forecasting, not for climate thing. And in her dissertation, which is soon to be defended, she showed that spectral nudging is not good for operational models. Would you comment on that? Because here you find good results.
So, for example, these runs are for long periods, climate runs, usually. And the spectral nudging technique isn't advised to use when you want to simulate, I don't know, a mesoscale convective system or something like that, because
quick cycles or something.
Something like that, because it doesn't allow the RCM to develop its own large scales, which are also necessary. So for climate runs, it is advised, and for runs over large domains, but I know that it's not a very good thing to use in operational models.
However, for climate, it shows it's okay because yes. It gives that statistics. More questions, more comments? The sun kills us all. Okay, well, thank you for a very clear presentation.
I don't know if Ivan Gita has some questions, but he hasn't reached us, so okay.
He can call us.
He can call us.